the first century of its existence, photography was a time-consuming process. It usually took days or weeks from the snap of a shutter to produce a physical photograph. Waiting until a roll of film was spent, bring negatives to a shop to be developed, and finally, having to come back to pick up printed photographs. The process was not fully private either. Lab technicians would see your photographs as they were developing. Polaroid, run by the pioneering inventor Edward Land, changed all of that with their development of instant film. Self-exposing film that transformed into a photograph within a minute of being snapped. By the 1960s and 1970s, instant film was a hit, and Polaroid sold their remarkable product through beautiful and functional cameras like the iconic SX70, a collapsible instant camera introduced in 1972. More than just instant photography, a Polaroid picture, as they came to be called, was a new, more social form of image making and sharing. With a fixed focal length and simple-to-use design, Polaroid cameras prioritized instant results that were meant to be shown off and passed around, giving Polaroid photos a unique aesthetic of instant snapshots. This look was captured by the pop artist Andy Warhol, who, like many Polaroid enthusiasts, used Polaroids as a tool for self-expression, creating images with a strong resemblance to today's social media photos. As media scholar Nora Draper has noted, in their advertisements, Polaroid highlighted this ability to instantly snap and share photographs with friends, emphasizing their social role over photographic quality. At times, Polaroid also seemed to be hinting at the new intimacy of being able to create photographs in a fully private manner. Their 1965 model Swinger camera carried an apt name, even if unintentional, for the sexual liberation and cultural hedonism of the swinging 60s.
Meet the Swinger, the incredible new Polaroid Land camera for 1995. It talks to you. Swing it up and take a look. Then turn the knob until it says yes, right in the viewfinder. Okay, you've got the right setting. 10 seconds later, you zip off a perfect black and white picture. The Swinger freezes action. It's always in focus. And it gives you beautiful close-ups. Incredible, especially at 1995.
Hey, meet the Swinger, Polaroid Swinger. Meet the Swinger, Polaroid Swinger.
It's more than a camera, it's almost alive. It's only $19.95.
Swing it up, it says yes. Take the shot, count it down.
As photography became cheaper and more accessible to the everyday person, the common visual language of photography became less rigid and posed. With easy-to-use cameras in hand, candid photography, which refers to photos captured without a posed or set-up appearance, gained prominence as a style of photography. Small, lightweight cameras like the 35mm Leica enabled photographers to quickly snap candid photos, also called snapshots, and capture a scene as it appears to the eye. The effects were transformative. From family albums to public figures, we've come to expect more naturalistic photographs of people. In the 1960s, President John F. Kennedy and his wife Jackie allowed their personal lives to be captured by photographers like Mark Shaw. These photographs, published in glossy magazines, helped create public fascination with the Kennedys. Many Americans felt drawn to the young, sun-kissed family. This heightened sense of personal connection was shattered when President Kennedy was assassinated in 1963. Yet, even in mourning, Americans bore witness to the family's pain. A now famous photograph of a 3-year-old John Jr. saluting his father's casket captured the grief that many Americans felt. In the second half of the 20th century, visually powerful, candid photographs started to shape public attitudes and define historically significant moments, no more powerfully than during the Vietnam War. In the past, showing the suffering of civilians during wartime, especially of the other side, had largely been off-limits to war photographers. But as the Vietnam War escalated in the 1960s, Americans had already come to expect a fuller picture of current events. The images coming out of Vietnam showed the violence and destruction of war in a close-up, visceral manner. Perhaps the most powerful image of the conflict was taken in 1973 by Nick Út, an American Vietnamese photojournalist. Út was positioned along a road as US bombers dropped napalm on a village, sending people screaming and running in terror, including a 9-year-old girl with napalm burns over much of her body. Út's photograph was initially controversial, given the full nudity of the child, but the Associated Press deemed it so significant that they published the image anyways. The photograph came to symbolize the toll faced by innocent civilians in Vietnam. Often called Napalm Girl, the harrowing photograph was seen around the world and went on to win a Pulitzer Prize. Today, it is one of the most famous images of the 20th century. Immediately after snapping the image, Út took the girl, Kim Phuc, to the hospital to treat her burns. She survived and went on to become a peace activist. Photographs like Napalm Girl forced Americans to face difficult questions, like why were American soldiers even in Vietnam, a small country that had never attacked or even threatened the United States? Seeing dead civilians and learning of atrocities like the My Lai massacre, many Americans were confronted with a sense of responsibility and guilt. This new viewpoint, being able to see the human cost of war, played a major role in growing the anti-war movement, led by young people that would help end the war. The US military left Vietnam in 1975 after more than a decade of war. Back home in the US, the anti-war movement itself was galvanized by powerful photographs, such as the killing of 4 peaceful student protesters by National Guard soldiers at Kent State University in 1970, a moment caught on camera and seen by the nation. Vietnam proved that photography could be a powerful force for shifting perspectives and changing public opinion, and since then, many militaries and governments, including the US, have at times sought to repress or control photojournalists to limit the kind of images that can be shown of a war zone. Photography as an art form was pushed forward by visionary and creative photographers, many of whom worked within a specific genre, from the panoramic vistas of landscape photography to the detailed intimacy of portraiture. In the world of landscape photography, there are few people as influential as Ansel Adams. Working from the 1920s to the 1950s, Adams photographed the natural beauty of the United States. Titled The Tetons and Snake River, this image is a good example of his style, depicting the Grand Teton National Park in Wyoming in 1942. His vast, detailed photos create a sense of transcendence, impressing upon the viewer the otherworldly and spiritual force of nature. Here, in this image, Adam captures the sublime stillness of a lake in Glacial National Park, also taken in 1942. Adams not only preserved the beauty of nature in his photographs, but he used his work to champion environmental conservation and protection of the natural world. The innate human desire to capture the uniqueness of a person has been a major driving force of photography from the beginning, and Yusuf Karsh, an Armenian-Canadian photographer, is considered a master of portrait photography. His minimalist black and white portraits reflected essential elements of his subject's personality and their historical significance. The optimism of First Lady Eleanor Roosevelt, the higher calling of civil rights leader Martin Luther King Jr., the frenetic creativity of artist Salvador Dali, the timeless style of actress Audrey Hepburn, the brashness of boxer and activist Muhammad Ali. Martin Chambi, an indigenous photographer from Peru, took portraits of the rural life and natural beauty of his country in the early 20th century. At a time when rural poor and indigenous groups were often portrayed in exotic or dehumanizing ways, Chambi used photography to counter such views and celebrate indigenous life. This photo of his, taken in 1960, is a compelling example of his work. It shirks the staged portraits often seen in villager, village life type photography. Instead, capturing a family in a moment of play that feels authentic and relatable to the viewer. When many people today think of portrait photography, they think of one name, Annie Leibovitz, the most famous and sought-after American photographer. Leibovitz made a name for herself with engaging, intimate portraits of public figures and celebrities. Her 1980 portrait of Beatles rock star and cultural icon John Lennon, posed intimately with his wife Yoko Ono, was taken just hours before Lennon was tragically shot and killed. The image is, in its own right, striking for its emotional vulnerability and as a kind of inversion of gender roles and expectations. Leibovitz developed an intimate style of portraiture, often using nudity. Her 1991 photograph of a nude, pregnant Demi Moore for the cover of Vanity Fair was controversial at the time, although lauded by many for embracing, rather than hiding, the beauty of motherhood. Writer Susan Sontag, a close companion and partner of Leibovitz, wrote an influential book of essays called On Photography, published in 1972. In her book, Sontag describes the allure of portrait photography. To take a photograph is to participate in another person or thing's mortality, vulnerability, mutability. All photographs testify to time's relentless melt.
Remember that picture I took of Richard with this digital camera? Well, look, all I have to do now is plug it into my computer, and it works with both a PC and a Mac. Choose the image that I want. I think I'll take this one, and I've got a picture in about 2 minutes. Pretty good shot, huh? And it's really fast, a lot faster than 1 hour photo. So with digital technology like this, driving to your local photo mat could be a thing of the past.
Digital cameras, which record images directly into memory rather than on film, allow cyber shooters to snap and download images directly into their computers. Most people shoot their pictures with conventional cameras and film. But now with digital cameras, you can actually store those images with removable memory cards like this, or on the hard drive, or even on the internal memory of the camera. You just connect the camera to your computer, download the images you want, and voila, you've got pictures.
With the turn of the century, digital photography would completely transform the world of image making. Initially scorned by many real photographers for inferior quality, digital cameras gained popularity in the 1990s, and by the early 2000s, the digital wave had almost entirely displaced film. In 2003, digital cameras outsold film cameras for the first time, and within a year, major companies like Kodak and Nikon had stopped selling most of their film cameras. The benefits were pretty obvious. No longer limited by the number of shots in a roll of film or the cost of developing negatives, digital cameras enabled users to shoot a never-ending stream of photographs. Easy to use with automatic exposure settings, these point-and-shoot cameras made photography easier, and best of all, with LCD screens, you could review your photographs in real time. Eventually, professional photography embraced digital. DSLRs, or digital single-lens reflex cameras, gained a foothold in the early 2000s with camera lines from major brands like Canon and Nikon. Unlike consumer-friendly point-and-shoot cameras, DSLRs used interchangeable lenses, had high-resolution image sensors, and manual controls that fused the quality of professional photography with the advantages of digital photography. Yet, it was the smartphone, with an increasingly sophisticated digital camera, that launched the true revolution in photography. With a 3.5-inch LCD screen and a 2-megapixel camera, the first iPhone, launched in 2007, may seem meager compared to today's phones, but it set in motion the explosion of image making and sharing that has come to define our current era. So what changed? First, convenience. Being able to pull a smartphone out of your pocket and immediately start snapping photos brought a whole new meaning to candid photography. And as a thin, always accessible device, the smartphone could take photos in almost any environment without drawing much attention. Second, connectivity. With a connection to the internet, smartphones paired photography with social networks and a growing suite of apps that populated the glowing screens of our devices. This always accessible and socially connected quality of smartphone photography is perhaps best represented by the selfie, a new kind of intimate self-photography meant to document one's daily life, shared in real time through messaging apps and social networks. Self-portraits have been around just about as long as photography. Here's one by photographer Robert Cornelius in 1839. Or another from an unidentified woman taking her photo in a mirror circa 1900. If we define selfies as the photographer holding the camera while simultaneously taking a self-portrait, perhaps this two-handed selfie by photographer Joseph Byron in 1909 is the first real documented selfie. Although this style of photography was not common nor very practical. Here he is again taking a group selfie with some friends. The term selfie became popular alongside the spread of smartphones, which started to include front-facing cameras, specifically for self-portraits. These self-facing cameras were first popular in Japan and other Asian countries in the 1990s. Found first in toys and cell phones, front-facing cameras ended up being an integral part of the smartphone revolution. In the year 2013, selfie was anointed Word of the Year by Oxford English Dictionaries. Long before smartphones and social networks, publishing and sharing digital photographs was popular in the early years of the web, on personal websites, blogs, or with photo sharing websites like Flickr. Flickr, launched in 2004, allowed anyone to upload and share high-resolution photos easily. And by enabling users to tag their photos with related words and other metadata, Flickr became a massive, open library of images that could be searched by anyone. But ultimately, it would be the social media networks, like Facebook and later Instagram, that gave digital photographs a new place of prominence in our culture and our daily lives. Have you ever found yourself on vacation trying to find something to photograph that would make a good social media post? Or have you ever felt regret or like you missed out when you were unable to visually document a memorable experience? In 2012, social theorist Nathan Jurgensen dubbed this melding of our smartphones with our sensory experience the Facebook eye. Writing in The Atlantic, Jurgensen explains, "Our brains are always looking for moments where the ephemeral blur of lived experience might best be translated into a Facebook post, one that will draw the most comments and likes." For Jurgensen, the ubiquity of smartphones and social media have embedded an ever-present social media eye into our perception, one that shapes how we look at and behave in the world. The constant engagement our images receive on social media drives us to see our daily activities as potential moments for shareable content, shaping everything from our social identity to our memories. As the popular phrase goes, pics or didn't happen. The prominence of photography in our digital lives is best found on Instagram, which began in 2010 as a photo-sharing social media platform. They even based their original logo on the iconic rainbow stripe of Polaroid's one-step instant film camera from the 1970s. Instagram not only created a social network around image sharing and social engagement, they also gave users easy-to-use tools for basic photo editing, like crop or exposure adjustments, as well as preset filters to stylize photos. This desire to share quick, stylized photos with friends grew Instagram into a giant among social media platforms, with over a billion active users. Everyday people and public figures alike use Instagram to give followers a more authentic and personal window into their lives, or at least what is supposed to look more authentic. This intimate, personal connection has helped fuel the power of influencers, or people who are influential due to their large followings on Instagram and other social media platforms, where they entertain, inspire, and inform, along with the occasional paid product promotion and self-marketing. Amid all these selfies, cat photos, and life snapshots, the cultural power of photography continues to be renewed and reshaped on social media. Humans of New York, a photo essay project started by Brandon Stanton on Facebook in 2010, sought to tell heartwarming stories of everyday people he bumped into in the city. With an intimate portrait photo and a transcribed interview, Honey, as it's called, told compelling, empathetic stories that reflected commonalities of the human experience. not unlike the photographers of the New Deal era who sought to tell the stories of average Americans during the Great Depression. Honey has inspired other social media photographers and has spread to hundreds of different countries and cities. Similar projects like Everyday Africa gained a popular following on Instagram and other photo-based apps around the world. A collective project that shares photos taken by people living in countries throughout Africa, it seeks to both normalize as well as showcase a more realistic view of everyday life. Their mission states, "We are creating new generations of storytellers and audiences that recognize the need for multiple perspectives in portraying the cultures that define us." Inspired by Everyday Africa, similar projects like Everyday Latin America and Everyday Middle East have popped up, along with many country-specific projects. In contrast to the Western lens of National Geographic, these projects redistribute the cultural power of image creation and sharing into the hands of former subjects, much in the spirit of early pioneers like Martin Chambi. One of the most influential grassroots movements of the early 2000s is Black Lives Matter, which has used images shared by activists to raise awareness of victims of police brutality and to humanize the costs of systemic and structural racism in the United States. The social media activism of Black Lives Matter echoes the innovative use of photography by abolitionists like Frederick Douglass in the 1800s and later photographs of police brutality during the Civil Rights era. Yet, one big difference is that, in the Civil Rights era of the 1950s and 60s, activists were dependent on the coverage from mainstream journalists, almost all of whom were white. Today's activists are able to tell their own story through the people-powered channels of social media. This authenticity of perspective can be seen in the work of photographers like Devin Allen, Sheila Bree Pright, and many others. There is an unmistakable quality of infiniteness and ubiquity to today's photography. Uploaded instantly and shared through social media, digital photography is not just a new development of photography, but is better understood as an enhanced form of social communication, what Nathan Jurgensen calls social photography. Social photography is, Jurgensen argues, much like talking and hanging out. It's closer to an augmented form of everyday interpersonal communication than it is an art form, hobby, or professional practice. Social photography is, essentially, conversational. Yet, unlike everyday conversation, social photos can engage a wide audience, hundreds of friends through a social media network, or even a viral photo might be seen by thousands or millions. That fluidity in the purpose of social photography blurs whatever distinctions existed between concepts like amateur and professional photographer, between citizen and journalist, between even friend and stranger. As an expression of the impermanence of social media streams, applications like Snapchat enable users to snap and share photos that, once viewed, disappear in a matter of seconds, like a spoken word or a comment that, once said, can only be retrieved through an imperfect memory or recollection. In this world of infinite imagery, the value of any individual photograph feels minimal. Perhaps this is why, from the beginning, platforms like Instagram sought to utilize nostalgic, analog aesthetics, like vintage filters that gave the ephemerality of social photography a kind of veneer of authenticity. A look of permanence taken from the past. Or why, with the rise of social photography, photo enthusiasts have looked to revive retro and non-digital forms of photography, like shooting on 35mm film or creating DIY darkrooms for home photo development. Once shuttered, Polaroid instant film cameras are back, thanks to a growing market of amateur photographers who seek the physicality and the scarcity of film. Photography has come a long way from its humble beginnings as a mystical contraption that could capture and freeze life. Yet that desire to puncture, with the snap of a shutter, the fleeting nature of life continues to inspire. The ever-growing prominence of the photographic image in our world speaks to its enduring power, as Susan Sontag so eloquently put. testifying to the relentless melt of time.